lot of this isn't going to make sense to you. And I'm sorry about that.
I'm just gonna start at the beginning, with the house.
Someone had put up a chain link fence, but it looked like I wasn't the first person to hop it. I lived here until I was 11, but I wasn't allowed inside half the rooms. Inside the mailbox were bills from 7 years ago, marked urgent, open immediately. I hadn't been back since my brother Lewis's funeral. In her will, my mother left me a key, but didn't tell me what it unlocked. Maybe she thought I'd know, or she thought that the mystery would be enough to bring me back. No one had driven this way in a long time, but I saw a few hoof prints. The truth is, even after I inherited the house, I never thought I'd come back to it. But now I had questions about my family that only the house knew the answers to. The woods around the house have always been uncomfortably silent, as if they're about to say something but never do. The house was exactly like I remembered it, the way I'd been dreaming about it. I asked Edie once about the dragon in the pond. She said it had killed her husband. I was 6. It seemed like an odd joke to me, even then. As a child, the house made me uncomfortable in a way I couldn't put into words. Now, as a 17-year-old, I knew exactly what those words were. I was afraid of the house. I hoped the key might unlock the front door. It didn't. Looking in, I felt like the house itself had been waiting for me. The house felt like it had always been here. Even the swing set was older than my mother. Prowling through the doggy door used to be a lot easier when I was 11. Power had been turned off the night we left. For the first time in years, I felt like I was home. But instead of a family, there were just memories of one. Like how after Lewis started working at the cannery, we all got sick of eating salmon. Except our cat, Molly. Or how only one restaurant would deliver to our house, so we had Chinese a lot. The table was still a wreck from the night we left. My mom was the only one of us who could imagine great-grandma Edie living in a nursing home. It was like a bomb had gone off, killing everyone but sparing the furniture. Nothing in the house looked abnormal. There was just too much of it, like a smile with too many teeth. Even the fireplace had a story. Edie told me the bricks came from the original house after it sank. Mom always told me to stay out of the basement, so I wasn't too surprised when the key didn't fit. Great-grandpa Sven built a music box for Barbara, along with the rest of the house. A lot of things got left behind in the whirlwind of that last night. Edie told me once that every finch who ever lived is buried somewhere in the library. After Milton disappeared, Mom sealed up all the bedrooms. Then Edie retaliated and drilled peepholes. My Grandpa Sam spent 7 years sharing a room with his dead brother, Calvin. As a kid, I just assumed every house had peepholes and sealed rooms you weren't allowed inside of. The last time I was in Edith Senior's room, I was 10 and she was painting my portrait.
Whenever people ask me about my family, the first thing they always want to know about is Barbara.
Mom must have locked the third floor stairs on the night we left.
Edie's father, Odin, built the original house.
Barbara was a child star for 2 years, until America grew out of it. Molly always seemed like a girl I could imagine being friends with, if she hadn't died in 1947. I spent a lot of time playing in Great Uncle Walter's room. I think my mom sometimes regretted not sealing it up.
Lewis told me there were secret passages, but I never believed him. Turns out, my mom was really good at keeping secrets. Now it was time to find out what my mom had been afraid of.
From the paintings on the wall, it was clear my brother Milton had been here before me. Reading this, maybe it sounds like I had a plan. But I had no idea what was behind that door. Just like I had no idea where all this was gonna lead.
I grew up looking at Molly's room through the peephole.
Molly's gerbil had a tiny bedroom with its own even tinier gerbil cage.
Being inside for the first time, I felt like I'd stepped behind a painting. I got the sense Edie had spent a lot of time here before my mom sealed the doors.
December 13th, 1947. Dear Diary, I'll be gone soon, but I wanted to tell somebody about what's gonna happen. It started when Mom sent me to bed without dinner. I woke up and I was starving, so I looked around for something to eat. My Halloween candy was all gone. The gerbil food was dry, but I didn't mind it. Mom, can I come out now?
Go to sleep.
I kept eating and eating. I ate a lot of things that night. then I heard chirping outside my window. It was a barn swallow going back to her nest. I reached out for her. And suddenly, I was a cat. I tried to be quiet, but the bird was really scared. Mom and Dad didn't even look at me. I jumped and I almost got her. I could tell she was getting really tired. Now I was up in the big tree. I promised Dad I wouldn't climb it anymore. All I cared about was eating that mama bird. I gobbled her up. And suddenly, I was an owl. First, all I heard was the wind. Then I heard little teeth nibbling in the grass. Looking up and seeing mine through my talons. I swallowed him up, and I didn't chew one bit. Then I flew off to find something bigger. A mama rabbit. She was almost too big to carry. I started choking, but I couldn't stop eating. And suddenly, I was a shark. I rolled off a cliff and into the ocean. Now, I was hungrier than ever. I wanted fat, juicy seals. I tore off her flipper and it tasted really good. Thank you. was so hungry, I jumped out of the water. When I opened my eyes, everything had changed. Now I was a monster, and I smelled people everywhere. It was big, and I knew it was real quiet.
Yes! Ah!
I wanted to stop, but also I didn't.
Thank you.
I'm not sure if I believed all of that, but I'm sure Edie would have.